And so, it was with Kashmir.
Kashmir has had a history of being an independent kingdom, a sovereign state in every sense, and whosoever tried to control it, whether it was the Mughals or the Afghans or the Sikhs or later the Dogras, has had problems, you know.
Born when a sage drained a lake to make a home for a people. Draped in myth, recorded in the Puranas, coveted by kings, conquered by various religions and ideologies. Kashmir has always been a land of many legends. Among her famous visitors were Emperor Alexander and Ashoka, and scholars like Shankaracharya, home to one of the subcontinent's greatest philosophers, the mystic Abhinavagupta. Kashmir has many stories to tell. Traces of its history can still be found in places like Buflias on the old Mughal road. Legend has it that this town that lies between Jammu and Srinagar gets its name from Emperor Alexander's horse, Bucephalus, which is supposed to have been buried here. Buflias is just the local name for a very Greek horse. This is the story of the state of Jammu and Kashmir, a story across time, from Alexander the Great, the Sultans and the Sikhs, and many others in between, to the current times and its state of affairs today. It is said to have all begun with the sage Kashyapa, who drained a lake that covered the valley at Varamula or Baramula to make a home for his people. And so the name Kashyapa Mir or Kashmir. Another story goes that a certain king Jambu Lochan fell in love with the land while on a hunting trip near the river Tavi. He made it his home and founded a town in his own name, the town of Jambu, or Jammu, as we call it today. Religion, like seasons, graced the valley at intervals. In the beginning, it was a well-known seat of Shaivism, an important pilgrimage for the followers of Shiva. And when Emperor Ashoka brought Buddhism to the valley, that flourished too, and both coexisted in harmony. Raj Tarangini, written by Kashmir's own historian Kalhana, records Buddhism as a prominent religion in the region and describes how it traveled from Kashmir over the mountains through Ladakh and Tibet to China, taken there by monks. At the same time, it remained an important center of Shaivism until the 14th century.
Whether you were a Mughal, a British colonial official on holiday, a Mongol on his way down to India, a Buddhist monk, all these people took their time and stopped in Kashmir. So in that period, in the 18th and 19th centuries, Kashmir played the same role that it had played since the time of Abhinavagupta and the early Shaivite period. This was always this zone of transition between China and India.
Sitting, as it were, in the shadow of the Himalayas, abundant in lakes, rivers and glaciers, Kashmir had always been a popular route into the subcontinent for traders, scholars and invaders, which was how Islam first appeared in the valley from over the Khyber Pass. And Shahamir, an immigrant from across the mountains, worked his way up to become king and established the first Muslim dynasty, the Sultan dynasty, which lasted till the 16th century. This was also the dynasty that made Islam the prominent religion in the valley, with some of its rulers even using political clout to enforce it. On the bright side, this was also the period when Sheikh Nuruddin Nurani, or Nanda Rishi, Kashmir's own patron saint, had lived in the valley. He introduced the land to a homegrown form of Sufism that preached and practiced coexistence. As Islam was not the only faith in the land, this lesson of tolerance and inclusivity became what would be sung by bards, quoted by poets, and internalized by a whole people as Kashmiriyat. To this day, Nanda Rishi's tomb in the town of Charari Sharif remains an important center of pilgrimage across faiths. Kashmiriyat. Here was a state of mind and a way of life that meant respecting all religious traditions and celebrating festivals of all faiths. This way of life is even said to have influenced the cuisine of the Kashmiri, the Wazwan, the ingredients of which became over time those that were acceptable to all faiths. The time and tide were such that it also attracted travelers and visitors from Central Asia, leading to a healthy exchange of culture and craft in the region.
Kashmir ka ek apna culture hai. Us culture ko jab Central Asia ki ya Shah Hamdan Ali Rahma ki wajah se jo tashreef layi yahan pe, to wo culture Islami tasawuf, Islami tahreek ka hissa ho gaya. To wo khan pan ki haisiyat se ho, wo pehnave ki haisiyat se, jaise hamare libas hai, ye sare mishran ki wajah se hamara ek culture ek aisa azim culture ban gaya ki jiski misal duniya mein aur kahin nahi.
Meanwhile, the land that had begun as a center of Shaivism now had seen the spread of Islamic faith for centuries. During the Sultan dynasty, the Hindus had become a minority. The Pandits or Brahmins of Kashmir were traditionally inclined to education. In the times of constant flow of visitors from over the mountains, the Pandits soon picked up the language of trade and exchange and became highly proficient in Persian, a knowledge that helped them serve their Muslim rulers for centuries, creating a community of ruling bureaucracy. On the other hand, the majority Muslim population were mainly artisans and peasants. So while the minority Pandits accepted the dominant Islamic culture, they controlled all the economic power because of their superior education. A clear trade-off and an indication of things to come. The 16th century arrived, and with it came the Mughals, who overthrew the Sultan dynasty. And Kashmir remained under the Mughals until the Afghans took over around 200 years later. Some Kashmiri historians have recorded the Afghan reign under the Durrani dynasty as one of religious oppression. Moreover, history records extortion, torture, and enslaving of the native population across faiths by the invaders. But this situation changed soon enough when the Kashmir Valley was taken by the Army of the Sikhs under Maharaja Ranjit Singh in the early 19th century. The region came under non-Islamic rule for the first time in close to 500 years. And this was the beginning of Kashmir as we know it today. It was the 1800s and the fortunes of the Sikh Empire was on the rise. The Maharaja, a fierce warrior and a curse to the Afghans since his early teens, had finally taken Kashmir from them. Ranjit Singh installed one of his trusted soldiers, Gulab Singh, a Dogra from Jammu, as the head of the state to rule in his place. Sikh governors were appointed in the valley of Kashmir to administer other regions. However, Gulab Singh, the blue-eyed boy, was granted complete autonomy so that he even maintained his own army. What's more, before long, the Maharaja granted Jammu to Gulab Singh as a hereditary principality. Gulab Singh had a great war strategist heading his army, the dynamic General Zorawar Singh. In 1834, the able general captured Ladakh, expanding the Sikh territory in the north.
This is a composite state. The state of Jammu and Kashmir was never a homogeneous state. It was a state built up by Maharaja Gulab Singh. Then he launched these great campaigns, Himalayan, Greater Himalayan campaigns, through Ladakh and Gilgit.
Gulab Singh continued his campaigns even after Maharaja Ranjit Singh's death. With the help of General Zorawar, he extended the Sikh Empire to Baltistan and Gilgit and Gartok near the source of the Indus, right up to Lake Mansarovar.
Jammu and Kashmir is perhaps the only state where the rulers, the Dogra kings, extended the frontiers of the boundaries right up to Tibet, China, Russia, and Afghanistan.
But all good war campaigns must come to an end. The Chinese and Tibetans who had fought the brave general were lying in wait for an opportunity to get back at him. And it came when General Zorawar Singh and his army were on a pilgrimage in the upper Himalayas. Weather played spoilsport, and the Dogra force soon found themselves in a spot. Stretched to their limits and travel weary, the Dogras were no match for a combined Tibetan and Chinese force. And so, General Zorawar Singh and 4,000 of his troops were killed near Lake Mansarovar in the Battle of Toyo in December 1841. But his valor was so legendary that the good general was honored by his enemies with a shrine on the battlefield, a humble memorial that still attracts tourists in Tibet. A year later, putting an end to the wars, the Emperor of China and the then Dalai Lama signed the Treaty of Chushul with Gulab Singh. Treaty of Chushul, 1842. We shall neither at present nor in the future have anything to do or interfere at all with the boundaries of Ladakh and its surroundings as fixed from ancient times, and will allow the annual export of wool, shawls and tea by way of Ladakh according to the old established customs. The boundaries of Ladakh and trade across the borders were restored. In return, Gulab Singh was granted a jagir of 3 villages near Mansarovar.
There was no dispute about the border. They reiterated the border, which clearly was Demchok, for example. And you know, in these days, it was not, you don't have a border following a range and like that. It's just more a trade route. And at one point you're in Ladakh and one point you cross. There was a small nala near Demchok, which said to be traditionally the border.
It is cruel irony that this well-intentioned, though ambiguous treaty that defined the border of Ladakh with China and honored for over 100 years would later become a point of contention. The death of Maharaja Ranjit Singh in 1839 had shaken the foundations of the Sikh Empire. The Maharaja had many wives and several offspring, but none had the charisma nor the hardiness to survive the challenge of monarchy. Gulab Singh, with much foresight, planned carefully to consolidate his position within this declining empire. He struck a convenient friendship with Colonel Henry Lawrence of the East India Company, the other emerging power in the region. The air was soon thick with whispers of Gulab Singh's secret alliance with the British. Though never proved true, history records that he stayed away from the First Anglo-Sikh War of 1845-46, which tipped the battle in favor of the British. The East India Company eventually won Punjab, even if it didn't come easy. A defeated Sikh force agreed to the Treaty of Lahore, a treaty that forced the infant ruler of Punjab, Maharaja Duleep Singh, to free his vassal lords, including Gulab Singh, which left him open to negotiating his own terms with the new overlords, the British. Soon, Gulab Singh signed a treaty with the British that made all his land an independent sovereignty under them. He followed this up with the Treaty of Amritsar, which allowed him to purchase more land from the British. By all accounts, this was an extraordinary document, and it should not be lost on anyone who cares to know that Gulab Singh's British ally, Colonel Henry Lawrence, was a signatory to it. In this treaty, the British, who now had taken over the Sikh Empire, sold a portion of that territory, which was the Valley of Kashmir and adjoining regions, to Gulab Singh for a sum of 75 lakh in Nanakshahi rupees, the currency of the Sikh Empire. An amount that was the exact cost to the East India Company in the just concluded Anglo-Sikh War. And this was how the Dogra dynasty was established, with Raja Gulab Singh receiving the indisputable and sacrosanct title to Jammu and Kashmir and being recognized as the Maharaja of this newly created political entity. In return, the British gained control over the defense, foreign affairs, and communications of this new and strategic state, while Gulab Singh remained its sovereign.
Post 1846, when Gulab Singh purchased Kashmir from Britishers, it became Jammu and Kashmir. So the entirety Jammu and Kashmir is a recent happening. It's just, 170 years old.
Neither Gulab Singh nor the people of Kashmir would realize the impact this transaction would have on Kashmir 100 years later. India, at the stroke of midnight, 14th August 1947.
Long years ago, we made a trip with destiny, and now the time comes when we shall redeem our pledge.
It was a destiny that was proving difficult to handle, because with independence came partition. The subcontinent was split in two, creating an Islamic Pakistan and a secular but predominantly Hindu India. What followed was an exodus of Hindus from the newly formed Islamic State to India, and Muslims from the new Indian territory to Pakistan. The flow of refugees to both sides was violent and bloody. While the subcontinent was in the throes of birthing of nations, Kashmir was in a state of confusion. Should she accede with one of the new nations or stay sovereign? To understand what Kashmir was at that point, we need to go back. To when Hari Singh became the Hindu king of a state with 77% Muslim population. Those were the days when nationalism was trending all through the subcontinent against British rule. However, in Jammu and Kashmir, it is directed at the Maharaja. In the 1930s, sees a political party, the Muslim Conference, formed by a young Kashmiri, Sheikh Muhammad Abdullah, that demands social and political reforms. Soon, the party is renamed the National Conference to include all Kashmiris. But when Pakistan, an Islamic state, becomes a strong possibility, some of its followers, unhappy with the secular nature of the party and with Sheikh Abdullah, revives the Muslim Conference. Together, both parties launch a Quit Kashmir movement against the monarchy.
The long suppressed soul of Kashmir, I would say, had a cry of anguish virtually in 1931, when there was a regularization of the protest with the formation of a resistance movement in Kashmir, which has passed through various stages, but I would say it's still continuing.
To kill the movement, the Maharaja imprisons Sheikh Abdullah for sedition. Nehru, a political ally and fellow freedom fighter, rushes to Kashmir to demand his release. The Maharaja promptly has Nehru arrested and unceremoniously escorted out of the state. An act that would cost him dearly in the time to come.
July 1947, Mahatma Gandhi came here. Mahatma Gandhi made a trip because they probably thought that Maharaja is undecided about accession. Sheikh was in jail. I was eyewitness. I was a student of SP College those days. In Srinagar, thousands of people had collected. They were shouting only one slogan, Baghi Abdullah ki jai. No other statement, no India, no Pakistan, nothing of the sort, no demand, except one slogan, Baghi Abdullah ki jai. And I saw Gandhi putting his two fingers in his ears, because it was a noise at that time of people. Gandhi is understood to have cleared the mind of Maharaja that you need not fear anybody. You decide whatever you have to. But release Sheikh Muhammad Abdullah immediately.
1947. India and Pakistan become realities. But Hari Singh, the Maharaja of Kashmir, is undecided.
Unfortunately, I think successive events overtook him. But yes, I would say he was under pressure to sign. And his initial objective was to sign standstill agreements with both India and Pakistan. That didn't work out because he felt that being a Hindu ruler of a largely Muslim majority state, he needed more time to think as to what is the best option for Jammu and Kashmir. And he didn't, at the same time, want to jeopardize the minority community in any manner.
The newly formed Pakistan is very keen to add Jammu and Kashmir to its territory. The reasons? Possibly the Muslim population and the six mighty rivers that flowed through Kashmir into Pakistan, forming the Indus River system, Pakistan's water supply. With no decision from the Maharaja, an impatient Pakistan launches Operation Gulmarg, a series of incursions aimed at annexing Kashmir. As a part of Operation Gulmarg, a Pakistan-backed no-tax uprising is instigated in the Poonch region among decommissioned and serving army men, mainly Muslim. The agitation soon turns into a full-fledged genocide of minority Hindus and Sikhs in this western part of Jammu district. In retaliation, Muslims are targeted in the Jammu province by the majoritarian Hindus and Sikhs living there. The state turns into a burning cauldron of communal violence. India strongly advises the Maharaja to release Sheikh Abdullah to calm the waters.
With this development, Maharaja's releasing Sheikh Mohammed Abdullah, Pakistan probably felt that India is taking, or it is going out of our hand. Meanwhile, they sent some emissaries to Sheikh, who were his friends. They were persuading him to join Pakistan. He said, "I have not made up my mind. We are fighting an independent battle. First thing is to get rid of Maharaja. Second is that whosoever accepts our conditions of accession, we will join that dominion. If Pakistanis accept, no problem. If Indians accept, no problem."
In another parallel attack, detachments of armed Pakhtun tribals under Brigadier Akbar Khan of the Pakistani Army and a local Punjabi politician, Sardar Shaukat Hayat Khan, invades the Kashmir Valley.
It was a very surprise attack, and Maharaja had to run away from Kashmir. He left Kashmir without any defense of Kashmir and all that, and his army led by Brigadier Rajinder Singh, it was wiped off in the very first attack up to Uri, and then it was a walkover for them. But they spent some time in Baramulla in looting and other things. So waste time.
Meanwhile, in another development, rebels of the no-tax agitation under Sardar Ibrahim, a lawyer, declare Muzaffarabad, Mirpur and Poonch Azad Kashmir. This region is known today in India as POJK, or Pakistan-occupied Jammu and Kashmir. Facing attacks from multiple sides, the Maharaja turns to India and agrees to accede for military help.
It was a very tense situation that built up. At that time, when we realized that the raiders are getting close to Srinagar, and then at that stage, I think VP Menon advised my father that it's better if you move down to Jammu, because any documentation that may be required has to be done in Jammu. Then we moved down to Jammu. So it was a very tense, and the instrument of accession was signed in Jammu on the 26th of October.
In October 1947, Kashmir accedes to India. The first Kashmir Accord is signed, and India sends in an army. Was it enough to keep Kashmir whole? It was not. Tacit British interference in Kashmir adds another dimension to the problem. To understand Britain's interest, one has to go back to the 1930s when communism had made its appearance in China. The Soviets had jumped into the Chinese Civil War, helping a faction win the Xinjiang province. This sent the British into a tizzy, as they believed the Soviets may not stop there.
You know, the British were always expecting, usually with a degree of paranoia, but and often with very little reason, but they're always half expecting a Russian army, an army of Cossacks, to be cantering down the Khyber Pass or coming down to Jammu through the valley. It never happened, but partly because I think the British were so wary of it and took so many precautions against it.
Gilgit was the last outpost of British India before the landmass merged with Xinjiang. So in 1935, the British leased Gilgit, an adjoining region, for a period of 60 years from the Maharaja. The Gilgit Agency was set up with a political agent who reported directly to the British. A Pashto-speaking army officer, Captain William Brown, was also appointed to study the land and locals.
For the British, Pakistan was a far more strategically important part of the Indian subcontinent. They wanted bases in Pakistan against the Soviet Union, as well as proximity to the Gulf, which had all the oil. So in Pakistan, the most important portion was Kashmir, and in Kashmir was Gilgit.
As the formation of two new nations drew close, the British hoped Gilgit Agency would end up with Pakistan. But they don't want their hand in this to be known. So merely 15 days before transfer of power in 1947, the British revoked the lease and returned Gilgit to the Maharaja, as they believed the then Prime Minister of Jammu and Kashmir, Ram Chandra Kak, would go with Pakistan. Kak had no affinity for the Congress. More importantly, he was on very good terms with those in power in Pakistan. The British thought it a foregone conclusion. Captain William Brown is promoted and given command of the Gilgit Scouts, a part of the Jammu Kashmir Army. All the pieces are in place. But palace intrigues in Hari Singh's court and Gandhi's view on Kak leads to his dismissal just 4 days before D-Day. British plans go up in smoke. And merely 2 months after transfer of power to the newly formed nations, Kashmir accedes to India, adding a new twist to this political page-turner. British plans for Gilgit go awry when Kashmir decides to accede to India. So they go to Plan B. A few days after the accession, Major Brown and his junior British officer in Gilgit Scouts lead the Muslim troops of the garrison to overthrow and imprison the Jammu and Kashmir governor, Kansara Singh. They declare Gilgit and its vassal states acceded to Pakistan.
I suspect, though there's no evidence has come out so far, that a signal was sent to Major Brown on 27th or 28th of October, and he then undertook what's called the Gilgit Rebellion, arrested Kansara Singh, and then handed over Gilgit to the British. That's why the British rewarded him with a MBE within 1948 itself.
45 years later, the Pakistan government posthumously confer on him the Sitara-e-Pakistan, one of the nation's highest awards, giving credence to this theory. So with Punch declared Azad Kashmir and Gilgit acceded to Pakistan, Kashmir is irrevocably fractured. In this scenario, Pakistan's proxy war with tacit British understanding gains ground. The constant unrest and violence wears thin Kashmir's already shaky relationship with India. It also denies Kashmir the autonomy as promised under the instrument of accession. Nehru is aware that this would eventually affect the dynamics with Sheikh Abdullah, Kashmir's face at that time. The British are no help, perhaps because they think Pakistan a better strategic ally than India in the emerging Cold War situation with Soviet Russia.
There's no doubt, from many points of view, that it was aggression by Pakistan. And we were intent, in any law or fact, to attack Pakistan. In order to avoid this war with Pakistan, we went to the Security Council.
Finally, Nehru approaches the United Nations.
We came here because we did not want this conflict to expand, to become more intensive, to spread into larger acts of war.
In April 1948, the UN Security Council asks Pakistan to remove all state and non-state actors from Jammu and Kashmir. India is asked to reduce its forces to minimum to maintain law and order and to install an interim government with all genuine stakeholders. After which the UN was to appoint a plebiscite administrator to understand the wishes of the people. Neither party welcomes the outcome. India had wanted UN to admonish Pakistan for interfering, and Pakistan is unhappy about the UN suggestion of plebiscite. Nevertheless, the interim government is set up, led by Sheikh Abdullah as Prime Minister and the Maharaja as titular head of state. India is glad for the reprieve, and Kashmir dares to hope for a future. But in 1948, Kashmir was more of a burning cauldron than paradise on earth. Even with UN intervention and an interim government, on ground, Kashmir was at war. Pakistan occupied Skardu in September 1948. The Indian Army took Dras and Kargil by November and secured the Srinagar-Kargil-Leh road. It also held the Zojila Pass, but advances no further following Nehru's orders.
I talked to General Kanwant Singh, who was in charge of this operation, that why did you stop here? He said, when we were advancing, we could have taken the whole valley. But I had no instructions, so I asked somebody who said he talked to Nehru, or he indicated the line, where should I stop? So I said, what was the reason why? He said, Nehru said, up to that point, it's Kashmiri speaking. After that, there's Punjabi Kashmiri speaking, so we don't want in this, and that's the line.
Sheikh Abdullah had informed Nehru that his influence did not go beyond the Kashmiri-speaking people. So Nehru did not go to war for regions where Sheikh Abdullah had no support, as he was not sure, even if the Indian army took them back, they would go with India. This whole process is a huge drain on India, which had a constitution to draft and a nation to build. Soon Nehru agrees to a ceasefire, and the first Indo-Pak war ends in a stalemate. India now had to prepare for a possible plebiscite, as advised by the UN, the first step to which was neutralizing the Maharaja.
My becoming regent didn't need any persuasion from Panditji or Sardar Patel. They first of all had to persuade my father to leave the state, which was a great shock to him, because after all he had acceded. And I remember saying that, you know, the Nizam fought against India and he became Raj Pramukh, and Maharaja Hari Singh acceded, and yet in a way he was exiled.
Hari Singh was no match for the combined political force of Nehru and Sardar Patel. A shocked Maharaja and Maharani are told that they would have to abdicate and physically leave the state for the greater good. Yuvraj Karan Singh, who is acceptable to all involved, is made regent and sent to Srinagar, where he meets Sheikh Abdullah and his entire cabinet. Marking a new chapter in Kashmir's checkered history. Since both India and Pakistan were dragging their feet on a plebiscite in Kashmir, the UN explored other options. The most significant one among those was the Dixon Plan. Sir Owen Dixon was an Australian jurist of impeccable repute. He did not believe in a consolidated plebiscite, arguing that the state of Kashmir was five distinct regions that merely happened to be under the Maharaja. According to him, since Jammu and Ladakh were mainly Hindu and Buddhist, they should be with India. Similarly, the regions of Gilgit and the Muzaffarabad Poonch Mirpur belt should go to Pakistan. The valley, with its overwhelming Muslim majority, could be put to a regional plebiscite. But Pakistan was not happy with this, as it placed Ladakh squarely in India. The Indus flowed from Tibet through Ladakh into Baltistan, a territory now occupied by Pakistan. This meant a good part of the river would be in India.
India has many rivers, and Indus is one of those rivers. And Pakistan has only one river, that is Indus. So whatever happens in the upper Indus basin or the Indus is having more impact on the Pakistan.
In time, the Dixon Plan was lost over multiple meetings, discussions, revisions, and rejections. Meanwhile, without the plebiscite, Prime Minister Sheikh Abdullah could not consolidate his position. So in 1950, he enacts the Big Landed Estates Abolition Act, a populist measure that impacts the Jammu Hindu and Kashmiri Pandit communities, who together owned most of the cultivable land in Jammu and Kashmir. The act stated that the land belonged to the tiller and not the leaser. The land-owning Hindu minorities face huge loss of property.
If you look at it today, in today's situation, it would be the most progressive land reform ever.
Sheikh Abdullah then announces an election, and in November 1951, the Constituent Assembly of Jammu and Kashmir is formed. The main opposition, the Praja Parishad, a party that represented the minorities in Jammu and Kashmir, had boycotted elections, citing irregularities, and the power remains mainly with the National Conference. The Assembly abolishes the role of the regent and elects Yuvraj Karan Singh as Jammu and Kashmir's first constitutional head, the Sadr-e-Riyasat. With that, the last traces of monarchy are wiped clean.
That was a time when there was some question as to whether, as they had already abolished the monarchy, whether or not I should accept. They offered it. They offered it to me. Perhaps that was part of the plan, I think. They needed me also to have some kind of a legitimacy, to have some kind of continuity in the whole thing.
Then Revenue Minister Mirza Afzal Beg announces that there would be no compensation for landowners whose properties had been attached under the Landed Estates Abolition Act. meant to appease the Muslim majority. This leads to violent protests from the Praja Parishad. Nehru is forced to intervene. After negotiations, the Second Kashmir Accord, the Delhi Agreement, is signed in 1952.
The point of the 1952 agreement was to somehow constitutionalize and institutionalize the relationship between the state of Jammu and Kashmir and the sector. It leaves a lot of the powers to the state.
Though the agreement made Kashmir an integral part of India, it also allowed Kashmir the right to its own flag and call its head of state Prime Minister. Furthermore, Jammu and Kashmir only had to abide by those provisions of the Indian Constitution that were in line with the original instrument of accession and ratified by its Constituent Assembly. To enable this, Article 370 is incorporated in the Indian Constitution, a key feature in the Kashmir-India relationship. It provided a reasonable autonomy to the state while making it a part of the Indian Union. But there were political activists in the country who saw it as a threat to India. Bharatiya Janasangh leader Shyama Prasad Mukherjee was one of them. He arrives in the state to support the Praja Parishad agitation against Kashmir's Land Reform Act that continued after the Second Kashmir Accord. Abdullah has him arrested, and Mukherjee inexplicably dies in custody. A series of events follow this incident. With Nehru's support, Kashmir's Sadr-e-Riyasat, Karan Singh, dismisses the Abdullah government and arrests him and some members of his cabinet. Simultaneously, the pro-India faction of the National Conference, led by Bakshi Ghulam Muhammad, is sworn into power. The Jammu and Kashmir Assembly reaffirms the state's accession to India and requests for closer links. By 1954, the state is placed under the President of India. Thereon, several central acts and presidential ordinances are applied to Jammu and Kashmir, so that by 1965, Sadr-e-Riyasat becomes governor and the Prime Minister, Chief Minister of State. Despite Article 370, the state has transitioned from autonomy to integration. Chief among Pakistan's many grouses was that its primary river, the Indus, flowed mainly within Kashmir. In 1960, Pandit Nehru and Ayub Khan signed the Indus Water Treaty to resolve this issue. Of the six rivers of the Indus system, Pakistan got waters from three: the Indus, Jhelum, and Chenab, all of which flowed through Jammu and Kashmir. The treaty allowed India to exploit 20% of the water from these rivers in her territory, a right she never exercised. If the reason for Pakistan's bid for Jammu and Kashmir was the rivers, this treaty solved that problem up to a point. But it still did not help calm Pakistan's strategic insecurities. With Kashmir, it was never just the one threat. One more that came into play in the 50s, wars from China. The Communist Party had won the Chinese Civil War and by 1950 had occupied Xinjiang and Tibet. They closed down the Indian consulate in Xinjiang, and in India, busy with internal problems, lets the incident slide.
One of the most crucial events which happened was the annexation of Xinjiang and the takeover of Kashgar. India had a consul general in Kashgar. His name was Captain Ramsate. He was originally from army, but he had joined the foreign service. Now China came and decided to close down, and India didn't react. I think it was one of the biggest and the first blunder.
China then turned to Ladakh, the borders of which had not been formalized since the Treaty of Chushul.
In Ladakh sector, in the western sector, again, the borders were left more or less as they were. And people can go for, they can travel 4 or 5 kilometers this way or that way without really being in a sure position to say whether it's Chinese territory or Indian territory. Suddenly we find that the Chinese are sitting right on our borders, breathing down our backs.
Nehru, also the External Affairs Minister, had received worrying intelligence from Lhasa on Chinese deployment in Tibet. He realized that Kashmir was fighting enemies on both her external borders. Perhaps for the reason, he decides to take a path of appeasement with the Chinese. Which was how India ended up shutting its consulates in Tibet and Kashgar in Xinjiang, and squandered the chance to settle this border issue in the Panjshir Agreement of 1954.
I think Pandit Nehru, his gravest mistake was the Panjshir and Hindi-Chini bye-bye. He just completely gave up these territories to the Chinese and literally with the desire to have nothing to do with these territories any further, which was a tremendous loss.
Perhaps encouraged by India's reticence to retaliate, China invades Ladakh in 1962, bringing the long-standing border dispute to a head. Soon they had annexed Aksai Chin in the northeast border of Kashmir and were planning a road linking Xinjiang in Tibet. Though it ends in ceasefire in a month, India takes a beating in the war. To add to this, Pakistan trades some areas in Gilgit-Baltistan, originally part of Kashmir, with the Chinese. Neither country consults the Indians or the locals. India also loses Minsar, a small principality in Tibet, awarded to Ladakh in an earlier peace treaty.
Almost half the area of my father's original state. We were 84,000 square miles. I reckon that 40 or 42,000 square miles are under Pakistan control, out of which they have leased many thousand square miles to China. So although it's an internal matter, what do we do about this? How do we settle this?
Sensing India fatigued physically and psychologically after the war, Pakistan launches Operation Gibraltar in 1965, named after a similar campaign launched from Gibraltar by the Umayyad Caliphate for the conquest of Spain. Pakistan hopes to repeat history.
They felt that perhaps a generation has changed and loyalties to India are not there, and probably the population will all revolt against the Indian presence there.
Troops named Gibraltar Force under Major General Akhtar Hussain Malik cross the ceasefire line and infiltrate India. But Pakistan miscalculates the mood on the ground. The infiltrators are caught and handed over to the police by locals.
What's your name?
Ghulam Hussain. Rank? Captain. Number? ACO780. What's your unit? 8 AK Infantry Battalion. What was the composition of your force? How many regular chaps were there in the company?
Well, every company had 43 people from army and 66 mujahids.
India retaliates with full-scale military attack. By September of 1966, a ceasefire is effected under Soviet mediation. It ends with the Tashkent peace talks that that simply sets the clock back to the 1949 ceasefire obligations. With so many vested interests in play, it was simply too difficult to recognize Kashmir's friend from foe. Nothing could have been truer for Indian Pakistan. The failure of any meaningful dialogue results in constant skirmishes between the two countries. And in 1971, it flares into a full-fledged war. The year begins with a hijack of an Indian Airlines flight from Srinagar to Jammu by the National Liberation Front, the precursor to the JKLF.
Maqbul Bhatt met me in Peshawar. He was living in Peshawar. And I was 6 months there, and National Liberation Front was struggling for the independent Kashmir. I joined that, and Maqbul Bhatt gave me training and arms and ammunition, commando training. There was a news that Eritrean freedom fighters attacked Ethiopian planes in Karachi airport. But just this news, there was another person, there was a lot of, just to say, why not we do this like that in India? Why not we hijack the aeroplane? And then Maqbul Bhatt asked me, can you do this, Maggie? Why not? And they trained me.
After the hijack, India bans Pakistani flights over her airspace. The Awami League had just won the Pakistan general elections, led by Sheikh Mujibur Rahman from East Pakistan. Geography and culture had always separated the two regions. General Yahya Khan cracks down on the league, and Mujibur Rahman is not allowed to become prime minister. This leads to violent protests that Yahya Khan suppresses with an iron hand. Soon, refugees start pouring into India from East Pakistan. The flyover ban hampers Pakistani troop movement. India sends aid to East Pakistani freedom fighters, setting off the 1971 Indo-Pak War.
Situation created by the Indian aggression is leading the two countries to a point of no return. We shall defend our honor. We shall defend the territorial integrity with all the forces at our command.
Pakistan launched a full-scale war against us.
It is a short war and ends mid-December with Lieutenant General A.A.K. Niazi surrendering to the Indian Army in Dhaka with over 90,000 prisoners of war. A new nation, Bangladesh, is born. At the same time, India also manages to liberate some strategic areas in Jammu and Kashmir from Pakistan. However, despite the resounding win, India does not push her advantage to find a lasting solution to the Jammu and Kashmir issue. After the war came yet another in the long list of accords, the Shimla Accord of 1972. President Zulfikar Ali Bhutto and Prime Minister Indira Gandhi sign it in Shimla.
Well, 1971, Pakistan was on a very weak wicket, you can say, a sticky wicket. But Pakistan even then did not relent 100%. The only point on which they relented was converting CFL, ceasefire line, into line of control.
The accord does not address the Kashmir issue further, and India returns the 90,000 prisoners of war to Pakistan. A lost opportunity. Back in Kashmir, there are signs of dissatisfaction. Among them, Al-Fatah, an armed movement with a cadre of 300 during the time of the Shimla Agreement. besides espionage, they are known for dacoity and armed robbery, which puts some of them in jail. After the Shimla Agreement, India initiates fresh talks with Sheikh Abdullah, leading to the Third Accord on Kashmir in 1975.
By then, this sense dawned on Kashmiris that you can't keep on fighting. If there's a window of opportunity, as they used at that time, that should be utilized.
This accord retains Article 370, but also gives the Indian Parliament the right to veto any act of the Jammu and Kashmir Legislative Assembly that could potentially disrupt the sovereignty or territorial integrity of the Indian Union. In a curious inclusion, the accord also provides for the release of all jailed members of the Al-Fatah and their integration into mainstream society. A day before the announcement of the accord, Sheikh Abdullah resumes as Chief Minister. The years that follow are of political unrest in India, led by Jai Prakash Narayan. Indira Gandhi is under fire for election malpractice, and the political situation is tense. Sensing trouble, Sheikh Abdullah starts distancing himself from the Congress and begins speculating on a possible merger with POJK. By now, he also feels he has compromised much in the Accord of 1975. By the 80s, the Abdullah government renames around 2,500 villages in Kashmir with Islamic ones. Sheikh Abdullah also delivers communal speeches in mosques. He begins singling out the minority Pandit community. The Islamization of Kashmir had begun. However, before he could give his plan a purpose, Sheikh Abdullah dies in 1982. Dr. Farooq Abdullah, his son, takes over as Chief Minister after a brief power struggle with his brother-in-law, G.M. Shah. Elections in the following year bring victory to Dr. Abdullah and the Congress. But the process is marred by violence. Much of the upper reaches of the Himalayas that bordered both India and Pakistan had been by and large ignored in the ongoing territory war, mainly because of the hostile nature of the landscape.
Sachin is one of the biggest glaciers in the Jammu and Kashmir, in the upper Indus. I think this is one of the glaciers which will be there even 300 years from now.
The glacier was difficult terrain and had been left out of all discussions. A fresh water reserve of 100 million acre feet. India receives intelligence of Pakistan shopping around for high altitude gear, which could have only meant one thing. Preempting the Pakistanis, India launches Operation Meghdoot to capture the 70-kilometer-long Siachen Glacier, its tributary glaciers, and some key passes in the region. India also captures 3,000 square kilometers of extra territory in Jammu and Kashmir. The ISI, meanwhile, are busy running the Punjab insurgency under General Akhtar Abdul Rahman. Kashmir was to be the next. Three Al-Fatah operatives captured at the time revealed that they had been sent back from POJK with money and told to wait for the call for Kashmir Jihad. This incident, among others, convinces Indira Gandhi to replace Dr. Farooq Abdullah.
Mrs. Gandhi was against his blood. Ultimately, they conspired, and in a very clumsy way, I should say, in a very unconstitutional way, they purchased his members. MLAs and pressurized. This is written by Nehru also. They were pressurizing Nehru to dismiss him. He said, no, I can't do it. It's unconstitutional.
So Governor B.K. Nehru is replaced with Jagmohan Malhotra and Farooq Abdullah with G.M. Shah. But India is soon mired in Operation Blue Star and its aftermath, Indira Gandhi's assassination and the anti-Sikh riots of 1984. Kashmir takes a backseat. Over the next 2 years, communal violence intensifies under G.M. Shah. In 1986, the Congress withdraws support. G.M. Shah resigns, and Kashmir comes under President's rule again. Later the same year, Rajiv Gandhi resumes a series of personal dialogues with Farooq Abdullah and brings him back as the chief minister of a coalition government with the Congress Party. A fourth Kashmir Accord is signed, and India stages Operation Brass Tacks. In scale, the biggest land exercise since World War II. This operation had troops mobilized and stationed just 100 miles away from Pakistan. Coming after the 1971 war and capture of the Siachen Glacier, this show of strength sends Pakistan into a huddle. They had to even the playing field.
Pakistan has been there right from 47, in one way or the other. They have never reconciled with this accession, and they have all along tried to do something. 87 election provided the ignition point.
The opportunity comes in 1987, when rigged elections spread unrest in the valley. Pakistan unleashes Operation Topak, their longest running operation in Kashmir. A number of events occur in India's political life, providing the right climate for Pakistan's Operation Topak. The Congress National Conference Alliance of 1987 creates ripples in Kashmir politics, driving those opposed to the alliance or the Muslim United Front.
In 1987, Muslim United Front decided to contest the elections. But all those elections were rigged. And the candidates which belonged to Muslim United Front were defeated. Those of the candidates who had suited for the elections, they were arrested and put behind the bars. Some of them, in order to aid the arrest, crossed the line of control. They went to other part of Kashmir. That was the beginning of this armed struggle in 1987.
It could be said that the 1987 elections was a defining moment in the socio-political history of Kashmir.
When Indian leadership unimaginatively and brazenly connived at rigging of elections, it produced a very pungent reaction from the youth of Kashmir. They took up the gun. They thought not the ballot, but the bullet should now decide.
Into this favorable climate of discontent, Pakistan introduced Operation Topak during Zia-ul-Haq's presidency.
Operation Topak Amru is a long-standing operation going on for the last 30 years. And within this Operation Topak, the Pakistanis had planned low-level insurgency in phase one. And in phase two, they had planned to escalate to a higher level of insurgency. And followed by in phase three, there would have been possibly a greater total uprising.
POJK, or Pakistan-occupied Jammu and Kashmir, functioned as a boot camp for young disenchanted Kashmiris who crossed over. They were trained, armed, and sent back into the valley.
There was a General Akhtar Rahman, Abdul Rahman. He called me there in his office. He says, "We are giving you a mission that you become a big leader of Kashmir if you start this." And they want, we brought young people from Kashmir and hand over to them, and they give them training, and they send them here.
The Indian Army was already fighting a fire in Punjab and was not trained to counter terrorism. when a bandh organized in Srinagar on the 40th anniversary of Kashmir's accession to India ends in violence, the army is unprepared. Militancy rages through Kashmir.
एक दिन ऐसा लग रहा था कि हम पाकिस्तान के ये इलाका कुपवाड़ा का हम लग रहे थे कि अब पाकिस्तानी हैं इतना इतने हालात हो गए कि लोगों ने अपनी गड़ियां आध घंटे पीछे की भाई पाकिस्तान के साथ मिले हैं हम
To add to this, news from the outside world, like the Tiananmen protest in China and Muslims rising against the Soviet Union in Armenia, Azerbaijan, Uzbekistan and Kazakhstan boosted militancy. So that 1989 sees bolder attacks. Jammu and Kashmir's BJP leader T.L. Taplu is assassinated. And Rubaya Saeed, daughter of Home Minister Mufti Muhammad Saeed, is kidnapped and held to ransom. She is later released in exchange of 5 jailed terrorists.
The new leadership of Benazir Bhutto perhaps was a little reticent about exploiting the situation, the emerging situation. But General Mirzaf Salbek, the then army chief, and Hamid Gul as the ISI chief, managed to prevail upon her with the byline that if they do not exploit the situation in Jammu and Kashmir in 1989, perhaps Pakistan would have lost the opportunity forever.
Meanwhile, in New Delhi, the Bofors scandal rocks the Rajiv Gandhi government and the Congress loses the 1989 general elections to the National Front led by V.P. Singh.
मैं विश्वनाथ प्रताप सिंह सत्यनिष्ठा से प्रतिज्ञा करता हूं कि मैं विधि द्वारा स्थापित भारत के संविधान के प्रति सच्ची श्रद्धा और निष्ठा रखूंगा.
When V.P. Singh is sworn in as the 7th Prime Minister, India had hit an all-time low in her political life. The army is caught up in the Sri Lankan civil war. Foreign exchange reserves are precariously low. And the country is dangerously close to bankruptcy. In these circumstances, Operation Topak gathers team under ISI Chief Lieutenant General S.R. Khalue. To the man on the street, it looked like Kashmir was going to Pakistan. It was not long before the raging communal fires began to scorch Kashmiri pundits in the state.
I think it is religious propaganda. And asking Kashmiri pundits directly that whether you are with us or against us. Obviously, no Kashmiri pundits are going to say that we are going to be with Pakistan. And they were threatened. And that threat converted into a very serious divide. And without Kashmiri pundits, there was no Kashmir really.
The exodus of the Kashmiri pundits began in the early 90s.
For the 100 years of Dogra rule, from 1846 to 1947, 101 years, it was the pundits really who were the secretaries, the joint secretaries, the people who did all the work.
Arvind Giggu had grown up in Srinagar. His family could trace their roots in Kashmir for several generations. In 1990, he was teaching in a college in the city.
I went to my college one day. I entered the premises, not a single student talked to me. Nobody came near. The principal of the college, Mr. Nisar, I knew him very well. He told me, "Chale jao yahan se. Take care of yourself. You are in danger." The conditions were bad. There was mistrust.
The year saw many abductions and killings. The victims included the head of Srinagar Doordarshan, Mr. L. Kaul, H.L. Khera, General Manager of HMT Srinagar, Mushir ul Haq, the Vice Chancellor of Kashmir University, and Ghulam Mustafa, a local politician. Anyone who had an opinion that was at odds with the militancy were eliminated.
The families of all the Kashmiri Pandits, they were in hell. They were scared. I know a Kashmiri Pandit, he grew a beard. He wanted to give this impression to the people that he was a Muslim.
Gigu now feared for his family. He sent away his teenage son and daughter to a camp in Jammu.
My parents sent me and my sister away to Jammu with our neighbors. So they called a truck and they boarded. All of us disappeared and I just looked behind what I was leaving. But that time I did not know how things would shape, and I had little clue that it would be forever. You know, me and my sister, we took shelter in a camp in Jammu, a large migrant camp which was set up for Kashmiri Pandits with hundreds of families, and I'd lost touch with my parents.
Torn from their ancestral homes, hundreds of Kashmiri Pandit families became refugees in their own country. The government of the day was helpless.
All Kashmiri Pandits thought that they would go back in 15 or 20 days. 20 days became 20 years. Now, nobody wants to go back. It is over. The division is complete. The division between Kashmiri Muslims and Kashmiri Pandits.
The political situation at the center also contributed to the mood on the ground in Kashmir. When the VP Singh government fell to the anti-Mandal agitation, followed by the short-lived Chandrasekhar government, which fell to bring on general elections, and when during these elections, Rajiv Gandhi was assassinated, all of it had an impact on Kashmir. The new ISI chief, Lieutenant General Asad Durrani, used all this instability to accelerate insurgency.
You see, borders are very porous. I have served in borders many times. We used to just go over, across, and come back. Today it's difficult, but at that time it was easy. In fact, so many times we walked about at least 10 kilometers inside Pakistan, watched their people and came back, and similarly they could. And there were not so much of vigilance because there was no such this thing.
General Durrani's strategy was simple. He sent militants across the border in plain clothes. The Indian Army in those days were not looking for terrorists crossing over the LOC. They were focused on military movements alone. There was no intelligence to the army to do otherwise. Operation Topak slowly and steadily corroded the fabric of normalcy in Kashmir. It was perhaps impatience that had ultimately decided Kashmir's fate way back in 1947. When the Indian Union was being formed, Sardar Patel was open to Pakistan taking the Muslim majority Jammu and Kashmir if it allowed the Hindu majority Junagadh and Hyderabad to go to India without a fight. But that did not happen. To add to this, the Maharaja of Kashmir hesitated to go with either India or Pakistan. And neither were the people of Kashmir open to the option of accession. In this scenario, an impatient Pakistan tried to forcefully annex Jammu and Kashmir. Sardar Patel dug in his heels, and India refused to let go of the land. Since then, The mood on the ground in Kashmir has constantly vacillated between Kashmir Banega Pakistan and Azad Kashmir. In one such swing of emotion, while insurgency was in full bloom, the Muslim United Front transformed themselves into the all-party Hurriyat Conference. It was 1993.
It represented political unity of the people of Kashmir. We seek a democratic right to be recognized, which is what it is. People whose right to self-determination. I should decide rather than a man in Delhi or a man in Islamabad.
The Hurriyat included, among others, the Jamaat-e-Islami, the Muslim Conference, Ittihadul Muslimin, the Mirways of Srinagar, the JKLF, and in fact all the stakeholders of the Muslim majority. Their demand was Azadi.
Azadi does not mean autonomy. Azadi means freedom, that Indian force should vacate state of Jammu and Kashmir, give the people their right of self-determination. They will choose about their future. That is Azadi. Azadi from the forcible occupation of Kashmir, Jammu and Kashmir state by Indian forces.
This political movement was supplemented with the religious radicalization of the population, mainly through the Ahle Hadith mosques that preached traditionalism and the authority of the Quran above all law.
The Ahle Hadith mosques in the valley have increased in number. There has been a higher rate of growth of these Ahle Hadith mosques. And in our calculations, as on date, there would be about 2,000 of these mosques, which about two decades ago or 15, 20 years ago was just in the range of around 500 to 1,000. Much of this increase of the Ahle Hadith mosques has been funded by money from outside the country.
The valley seemed poised to opt out of the Indian Union. In 1994, the ISI set up the United Jihad Council in Pakistan to manage the terrorist arms.
Our struggle is a legitimate freedom struggle. It can never be categorized as a terrorist movement.
Both the Hizbul Mujahideen and the Hizb-e-Islami, the sword arms of the Hurriyat, report to the council that is currently run by Sayyid Salahuddin of the Hizbul Mujahideen. And as the security forces grappled with the enormity of this problem, India sent out a strong political statement with a resolution in Parliament.
The resolution passed by both houses of Parliament, all parties put together, that joint call by the Parliament was very clear that the entire territory of Jammu and Kashmir, which was once under the possession of the Maharaja of Kashmir, actually belongs to India, and that India will continue to work towards it and aspire towards ensuring the return of all territories to the Union of India.
Reiterating Sardar Patel's stance of 1947, India was now unwilling to back down, even in the face of relentless insurgency. Not long after, foreign terror outfits like the Lashkar-e-Toiba, the LET, arrived in the valley. They added to the efforts of native organizations like the Hizbul Mujahideen and created disruption under the Jihad Council in Pakistan. And through all this cross-border terrorism and Indian Army's countermeasures, the biggest casualty has been the man on the street. Parveena Ahangar made the Association of Parents of Disappeared Persons in 1994 after her 16-year-old son went missing.
किस लिए रखा 7 लाख फौज? रखवाली करने के लिए। वो कहाँ रखवाली करता? वो मारता हमारे बच्चे कोई से अपने ही है। कितना फेक एनकाउंटर किया, कितना कस्टोडियन करने किया, क्यों?
And the list of losses doesn't end there.
Lakhs of people suffer. Whole Kashmiri Pandit community has been thrown out, away into exile. In the valley itself, tens of thousands of Kashmiris have died. There are graveyards in almost every village. Widows, the wailing of the widows and the cries of the orphans. Koi sun raha hai kya? You can't brush that aside as if it's only collateral damage.
Between 1993 and 97 alone, more than 1,000 security personnel have lost their lives. The actual human toll of this war has probably exceeded the value of the very land the battle is being waged for. What then is the price being paid? And who is paying it? In Kashmir's constantly moving graph, two significant blips register in 1998. The first is that both India and Pakistan become nuclear powers.
Today, at 15:45 hours, India conducted 3 underground nuclear tests in the Pokhran Range.
The first is that both India and Pakistan become nuclear powers.
The nuclear explosions of Pakistan of 28th May and 30th May have helped to establish military and political parity between Pakistan and India. And we feel this is again a major development which has qualitatively altered the life and destiny of the 1.2 billion people of South Asia.
The second, Pakistan indiscriminately shells the border town of Kargil. India does not react. On the heels of achieving nuclear capabilities, Pakistani Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif and Indian Premier Atal Bihari Vajpayee signed the Lahore Declaration in 1999, resolving to implement the Shimla Agreement, bring peace to the region and settle the Kashmir issue. However, the ink had not yet dried on the document when Pakistan's army chief, General Musharraf, attacked Kargil.
On 9th of May 1999, Kargil was hit again. And at that point of time, the main ammunition depot of the Indian Army, which was located in the middle of the town, it was hit. And for next 2 continuous days, it was, if I can say, it was more or less like Diwali. That's when we realized that the Pakistanis have moved in and occupied the peaks, right from Dras till Batalik. That's about a stretch of about 153 kilometers.
The Indian Army recaptures each peak in a 2-month-long conflict. The raw courage displayed by the soldiers become legend. There are heavy casualties on both sides. The Lahore Treaty among them. militancy ebbs for a while in the wake of Pakistan's resounding defeat in Kargil, leading to another high-level meeting in 2001. Parvez Musharraf, now the president of Pakistan, meets Prime Minister Vajpayee in Agra.
There was great enthusiasm on the part of President Musharraf and Prime Minister Vajpayee to do something. But my conclusion is it failed for the simple reason that not enough homework was done.
Barely 5 months later, there is an attack on the Indian Parliament. The terrorists are identified as Lashkar-e-Toiba and Jaish-e-Mohammed, led by Maulana Masood Azhar, who had been released by the Indian government during the 1999 Indian Airlines hijack that had taken civilians hostage. This attack on the symbol of Indian democracy stalled any peace talks for a while. India reacts strongly, demanding that Pakistan arrest the leaders of the outfits and freeze their financial assets. Troops are also mobilized in the borders of Punjab and Kashmir. The biggest since the 1971 war. In the shadow of heightened security, Kashmir goes to polls.
आप लोग अपना वोट देंगे मुफ्ती मोहम्मद सईद आपको वादा करता है हर सूरत में जम्मू कश्मीर के लोगों का इज्जत और आबरू का मजा
A new regional party, the People's Democratic Party, wins the elections, bringing hope for development and normalcy, both of which had been disrupted by years of militancy.
मैं अटल बिहारी वाजपेयी मैं संघ के प्रधानमंत्री के रूप में अपने कर्तव्यों का श्रद्धा पूर्वक और शुद्ध अंतकरण से निर्वहन करूंगा.
The new millennium starts off promisingly enough with a stable government at the center under Vajpayee and a new one in Kashmir under Mufti Muhammad Saeed of the PDP.
We had a fresh election and people of Kashmir had first time thought, got this idea that yes, we can have our own chief minister. There was for the first time, none of the old gods, none of the family of the Sheikh Abdullah in the assembly. So they thought, no, this is our moment.
Kashmiris demand development, peace, and the two nations, India and Pakistan, to sit down and sort the Kashmir issue. It was right after the 9/11 attack of the World Trade Center, and the USA was also strongly urging for peace.
President Musharraf, he must stop the incursions across the line of control.
A ceasefire is effected in 2004, and Prime Minister Vajpayee even travels to Islamabad. The government under Manmohan Singh that follow also keep up the momentum, continuing discussions away from media glare. Trade is opened across the LOC, and there is fresh emphasis on development, governance, infrastructure. By 2005, the Srinagar Muzaffarabad bus service starts. Kashmir was coming alive.
The opening of this LOC, which is in the psyche of Kashmir, a big thing, perhaps the biggest thing. When people saw delegates coming here from the other part of the LOC, people going from here, the politicians going across, trade delegations coming from there. I have not, in my own 65 years of life, never witnessed that activity, that buzz, which we witnessed in those 3-4 years.
And Operation Topak was on the ebb. By 2007, close to the end of the Bush presidency in the USA, it looked like India and Pakistan were close to an agreement.
The win-win formula is there could be no change in borders. We started giving hope to the people of Pakistan that Jammu and Kashmir will be resolved peacefully.
And then, just as quickly as it had built up, the momentum is lost. In late 2007, Parvez Musharraf resigns as army chief, and by August 2008 had resigned as president and fled to England.
The moment Musharraf left, the military changed its mind.
As if by magic, Operation Topak was back in action. Nearly like there never was any real intent to solve the Kashmir issue. Also, the stakeholders in the state not being part of any of the bilateral meets continued to haunt the peace process.
Jammu and Kashmir as such remained unrepresented. Any conference that you take when India and Pakistan meet or they decide to meet at all, even to sit down and disagree or state their point of view, not go beyond that, Jammu and Kashmir has never been a part of it.
Development and infrastructure suffer. And tourism, which had revived for a while, starts to decline.
2004 se lekar last year tak pura tourism aa raha tha 13 14 lakh ka figure hota tha per year to bahut tourism aa raha tha lekin thode halaat kharab hone ki wajah se tourism flop ho gaya hai.
The generation of Kashmiris born after the early years of accession and insurgency was now looking at a bleak future.
I'll tell you, sir, that 1947, 53, 75, 77 may be important for me, but this young man is post-1990. He's not interested what you did in 1947. He's interested what is there for him tomorrow. And he is to be addressed.
Could there be any hope for normalcy? So what kind of a generation does life in the shadow of such instability create? The average Kashmiri believes that the mainstream media in India only tells the political story.
JK1539, Insha cricket story.
So for one, it has created a new generation of Kashmiri journalists, like Sajid from Video Volunteers, trying to change just that.
Our priority is to go deep into the places which are missing from the media discourse and get those stories covered and get the issues resolved at the same time. It talks more about the communities which are left over by the media.
The issues at the ground level, though, are far too many. And some, like the Armed Forces Special Powers Act, too political. The repeal of which has been a long-standing demand of the Kashmiris.
AFSPA is an undemocratic institutional framework.
This and some other political decisions create yet another set of youth in the state, where hope and despair play hide-and-seek constantly. In early 2008, the state and central governments allocate land in the Kashmir Valley to the Sri Amarnath Ji Shrine Board to set up shelters for pilgrims. The valley agitates. The youth express themselves with fist-sized rocks, and stone pelting soon emerges as a form of protest. And when security forces faced these youth, replying to stone with bullets, those killed in the firing are quickly anointed martyrs. With this, the ISI had convinced the stone pelters that they were part of a worldwide Muslim protest movement. In the face of snowballing violence, the decision is repealed, leading to more protests from the Jammu region. The state is split wide open with violent agitations against and for the land transfer. In despair, the Jammu and Kashmir government falls, leading to an election. But when young Omar Abdullah wins and comes to power, it also brings hope of the repeal of the AFSPA, among others. But the act was to stay as long as Operation Topak was in play.
But as long as you ask the army to do something outside, what is otherwise the job of the army is to defend the borders. If you're asking them to maintain public order, then you have to then give them what they want. So the idea is really of speaking to the army. It's not the political leadership that should engage with the army to determine whether this law is still necessary or no longer necessary.
Another section of youth of the same generation, victims of the same insurgency, were facing laws of another kind.
The children who have been born and brought up here, I think they're children of exile. They have an inherited memory, but I wonder what their ties with Kashmir are, how they perceive themselves.
Time, the pundits believe, has made them a forgotten people. Having lost their homes, their land, their once stable lives, they are now refugees in their own country. At this juncture in history, what are the practical options open to Kashmir? Complete autonomy? In which case would her borders ever be safe? Be divided between India and Pakistan? If that is done, would she survive another partition? Or be split in three?
There's no need for the Kashmiris to rule over the people of Jammu. There's no need for the people of Kashmir to rule over the people of Ladakh. Kashmiris don't seem to be reconciled to the special position which they do enjoy, even now, in the constitution. So I feel that maybe it's a time now when maybe trification should take place and Kashmiris should be held accountable for their own development.
Or is there another way to broker peace? China has been in this fray since the very beginning, as she shares a 4,000-kilometer-long border with India and a 70-year-long dispute over most of it.
See, China's problem is, it has been their style in history that they are continuously progressing into the enemy's territory and making claims on enemies or the adversary's territories as a part of defense also.
To add to this, Pakistan has colluded with China, trading land at the border for strategic gains against India. In 2013, China and Pakistan announced the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, which essentially is a series of infrastructure projects in Pakistan. At the center of this is the plan to import oil and gas from the Pakistani port of Gwadar through pipelines over the Himalayas and Karakoram to Sinkiang.
First of all, the route will pass through Gilgit. There'll be over 7,000 trucks which are going to be plying through that every month. Then they propose to set up what is called special economic zones, one in Gilgit, Baltistan area, and one in the so-called Azad Kashmir.
Last known, the CPEC was worth $62 billion. And here is the clincher. The CPEC will not only occupy vast tracts of what was once Kashmir, but will also depend heavily on the Indus to generate the power needed for it. This is where Jammu and Kashmir becomes important to both Pakistan and China, and puts India in a position of power as she sits on the resources they dearly need.
There is not an inch of doubt that Pakistan will fight to live. Because if India ever decides to play with our water, and there is potential for it.
Could India leverage this to open a dialogue to peace?
Pakistan has been harping all along on the Muslim issue. The identity of Jammu and Kashmir being majority Muslim, but actually behind it is this thought that if Jammu and Kashmir is not under the control of Pakistan, then a time will come that a water-weary country like Pakistan, which is hugely water deficient, is going to be under the thumb, under the control of those who control the waters. And we are all aware that all the waters which flow into the Punjab, into West Punjab or East Punjab, the sources are all in Jammu and Kashmir. This worries Pakistan to a very, very great extent.
The last 5 years have witnessed an escalation of violence in the valley as well as beyond, with incidents such as the terror attack on the Indian Air Force base in Pathankot, Punjab. The death of Hizbul Mujahideen commander Burhan Wani at the hands of Indian security forces, spinning out into violence on the streets. And the terror strike on Indian security forces in Uri. Add to that the surgical strike carried out by India on terror outfits in POJK in 2016. And the Indian Army's one-off ploy of using a local man as a human shield to control a stone-pelting riot last year. The road to peace looks nearly non-existent.
These things I have only done to save the local people. Had it been I have fired, there would be more than 12 casualties, which I have not done. But with this idea, I have saved many people's lives. Those were 1,200 stone pelters, including those boys whom I have came to rescue them.
That India needs a change of strategy to deal with Kashmir is clear. And pellet guns may not be the answer.
When you talk of pellets, we talk of non-lethal weapons to deal with land under situations. Of course, there have been cases where death has caused due to pellet injuries, but that was bad use of the weapon.
They have caused injuries that have permanently disabled many victims, reinforcing the feeling that Kashmiris are just collateral damage. Any goodwill earned by the army during the relief work of the 2014 Kashmir floods has long since dried up.
My God, my God, my God!
So the question is, what now? If India puts down her thumb on the water flow to Pakistan, will it help initiate dialogue, or will it lead to yet another war? One thing though is clear, no progress can be made unless there is the will and a sincere intent from all involved to find a solution. Be it Kashmiris, Hindu and Muslim, Pakistan and India.
If you want a better future, like if you want our generation, our next generation, to get a better future, first we have to change ourselves, because when we change ourselves first, then we can change our world too.
security operations are suspended for the month of Ramadan in May and June 2018. During this period, journalist Shujaat Bukhari, editor of Rising Kashmir, is shot dead. The same day, an army jawan is abducted and his bullet-ridden body is found a day later. The PDP-BJP alliance falls on the 19th of June 2018. Jammu and Kashmir comes under governor's rule for the eighth time in 7 decades. Kashmir still awaits her paradise.